Welcome to Calvary Conversations. My name is Mariah, and I'm here with Pastor Craig Roders.
Hey.
Today, we have a very special guest who is a wife and mom of three. She'll be sharing her testimony from New Age to Jesus, and now she has a podcast, a Faith to Freedom podcast. And she's also a Christian businesswoman who is going to now be sharing with us her testimony. So without further ado, it's my honor and privilege to welcome Tracy Wren.
Tracy, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Yes, and we got to meet you from actually, I remember you put a comment in one of the videos and you were just so encouraging to my dad. It was in one of the Stephen videos and all these people were kind of shredding my dad and saying, "You're talking too much, let Stephen talk." And I saw that one encouraging comment where you're like, "Pastor Craig, what you said is like so encouraging to me." And it was just like speaking right to my heart. So I told my dad that and it was actually cool because then I'm just like, okay, I looked up your name for some reason on Instagram and all of a sudden I saw that you used to be a New Ager and Law of Attraction and now you are a Christ follower and I was just like, oh my goodness, and that you had a podcast and it's like a really, I started listening to your podcast, Faith to Freedom, and so anyway, you're inspiration to me and so it's cool, I got to reach out to you and you responded and so yeah, I'm excited to be able to have you share your testimony to everyone here, but Dad, before we start, do you want to pray for us?
Amen. Father, I just thank you so much for Tracy, and I thank you so much for just, as David said, you taking me out of a miry pit and placed me on the rock, and I thank you that you've done that in her life, mm-hmm. and I believe she's going to share today that, Lord, you saved her instantly, but the transformation, it's the sanctification is a process, and Lord, I just thank you for her life. I thank you for her family, even though I don't know them personally, but I thank you that there is one person that believes I have something to say, just like Stephen. No, I'm kidding. But Lord, we just thank you and we just pray that you would bless this time. Lord, as your word says in Proverbs, whatever you commit to the Lord, it shall be established. We pray your will be done. We pray that you would give her liberty to share what you would have her share, nothing more and nothing less, and that it would just really be a blessing to those who've come out of the New Age lifestyle and maybe even have struggles or the residue of their past, that she could be used by you, anointed by you, enabled by your Holy Spirit to speak truth to speak light and truth to the darkness, and that your truth would expel that and people would be set free, Lord. That's your desire, to set the captives free. And we know that someone can be saved and still be held captive in a sense by wrong thinking, by lies they've believed, what people have said over them. And we just pray that you would just really use this time to speak to people who come out of that similar lifestyle and to really see. And other people, maybe people have just been Christians all their life but have had a hidden life. Mm-hmm. Use this. And we just thank you for her making the time to be with us today. We pray you'll bless it in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
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 All right. So first question is, tell us a little bit of your upbringing.
Yeah. So I'm born and raised in northeastern Pennsylvania. I've been here all of my life, but I have traveled just a little bit in recent years with my husband, only because I don't like to stay in one spot for too long, so just traveling is really fun as much as we can with the three kids. Mm-hmm. I grew up very non-traditional. What I mean by that is I have 8 siblings. My 9th was later adopted by my mom, and I grew up with 3 moms, 1 dad.
Wow.
So kind of like sister wives, but a little bit not as unified, if you will. And so but with that, there wasn't really a foundation of belief. There wasn't, this is who we believe in, this is what we do. There wasn't just like that structure. But my mother would always tell me one sentence and one sentence only, and it was, "I don't know anything about God," because I always had questions. I always just had questions. I always knew there was something more. And so I would just ask these random questions and she would have no idea to answer them. And the only thing that she would say is, "Tracy, all I know is if you just believe that Jesus is the Son of God, you'll be saved."
Wow.
And that's the only thing I ever heard as a child. And then I would be like, "So is Jesus God? Is God Jesus? Is Jesus like invisible? Is he watching me? Is he around?" Like, I always thought about that concept. And then I was just like, okay, so I have to have like this hope and faith in believing that Jesus is the Son of God, whoever these people are. Okay, great. I'm going to be good. So that kind of like set the stage for my life, like with the religion and beliefs growing up. Fast forward, my mom left my dad because she wanted marriage. He wouldn't commit. All of them great people, just amazing still. But I was 12. I was 12 when the school nurse, this is where everything started for me before I like went into deep new age. I was 12 years old as a school nurse and they were doing scoliosis checks. I had no idea even what that was. So we'd go down there. All the girls would line up. We would bend over, touch our toes. She would check our back. Well, she had me bend over, touch my toes. And she's, and I remember the gasp in the look on her face. And she said, you need to sit down. And she continued the other kids and they went back and I was so upset and embarrassed because I was like, everyone's going to think I have lice because like you took me out of you know how they do lice? They were just, they would do lice checks in public school, but now they're doing scoliosis checks, but thank the Lord they did. So they call my mom. My mom's like, what is this? Before I knew it, within the time that they found my scoliosis, which is the curvature of a spine, until about 5 months later, my curve was almost at 80 degrees. They say you get surgery around 20 to 30 degrees. So my spine was the shape of an S. Wow. I didn't even know it. I didn't have pain. I didn't have breathing issues. I was always shorter and small and petite. So I just, nobody ever knew of it. Well, we did the back bracing, didn't work, had to go in for major spinal correction surgery. I was there for my 13th birthday. I was in surgery for my 13th birthday, right? Right. And that traumatized me. I woke up, I will never forget it. And it was also the first time I got my menstrual and I had a catheter. They thought I was bleeding out and dying. So all the doctors rushed in because they thought I was dying and that I was having internal bleeding, which I wasn't. It was just my menstrual. And they looked at me like, how could you not care what's happening? Because I was filled with anger. I was mad that I was in this hospital for a spinal correction surgery at 13. I was mad that I had to learn how to sit up, how to balance, how to just like get out of bed, how to redo stairs. Like I was now filled with wrath. And from that experience, and also addicted to Percocet at 13, from that moment being opened up to Percocet and antidepressants, because now I'm depressed, now I'm angry, now I'm in pain, and I hate the world, that is where I kind of strayed away. Like, I didn't care about my martial arts training anymore. I didn't care about school. I went into the bad crowd, sex, drugs, just everything from that point on.
Sorry to interrupt, but were you... were you, Tracy, were you angry at God or just angry?
I was angry at my mom that she had me get the surgery.
Oh, okay.
And later on, I found out, she's like, I didn't tell you at the time, Tracy, but your scoliosis was progressing so quickly that they said if you didn't have it within the next months, you would have been paralyzed in a wheelchair. Oh. So you needed to have it. Yeah. And then I just want to also say this because I feel like the devil's always been after my life. Because my mom, I was born in 88, but somewhere in 87 and 88, my mom said there was this new testing for pregnant women that determined if there was going to be some type of brain injuries in their babies. And she was in this study with three other women and they all had the test. And the doctor said, all of you came back with this test and you should abort your baby because your baby is going to have brain damage. She was the only one out of that group that didn't abort. And here I am. So I feel in a sense like the enemy is just like always knew I was going to be doing something for the kingdom in some way, some form. And I just like kept on going through and thank God for my mom for telling me, hey, just so you know, there is a Jesus and a God, even though I have no idea what that is. But so that's where anger and wrath started. Then into the bad group. From the bad group, the marijuana, and the marijuana led to a really so it was laced. I didn't know that. Whether it was LSD or whatever, I don't know. But all I do know is I tripped massively and I thought I was dying. From that moment, anytime my body would feel off, I would go into like a panic attack. So if my, if I would feel pain or my body being off, I would go into a panic attack. And so that led me onto the search of directing my faith into something else to remove fear. Mm-hmm. Like I was on a mission to remove fear in my life. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's funny you say that about like a saying about martial arts. I was into martial arts and it was funny how I always say to myself, it's like when I see a real macho guy, I always see like really he's just a little kid scared trying, you know, bodybuilder. And that's the way I was. I heard this guy and he had fought Chuck Norris. And so he's a Christ. So I thought all Christians are wimps. You know, I used to be pretty studly. Now I'm one of those wimps. But anyway, but I remember hearing that, you know, he was saying that I was insecure. He was saying how Chuck Norris had a lisp. And he was saying, and he used to be here at Globe, Arizona, right by us, about 60 miles away. But anyways, so I realized that that was me. And when he's saying this is before I'm a Christian, and I'm just going, shut up, you know, because it was like I was trying so hard to put this facade that I was so not afraid. I would kill anyone, you know, and yet I was just this little kid sucking his thumb, terrified, but trying to put this big exterior. I kind of call it like a blowfish, trying to look all tough. Yeah. And it's amazing how we try without Jesus, how to bask all these deep insecurities. But because I had, you know, I should have been aborted. Born in 62, so I would have been aborted if it was legal. And it's funny, I'm going to pray for 40 days of life, and it's kind of say it's weird that I'm praying for the start of the 40 days of life when I should have, my mom was thinking about going to Mexico, because back then you'd have to do it legally. But so pretty crazy, exactly. Similar story. So and that's why you smell something kind of similar.
No, exactly. Anyway.
Yeah, I knew when I heard you speaking with the interview with Stephen Bancars, there was just something there. I'm like, there's something here. There's something more, Lord. I don't know what it is, but there's something here. And that the hearing of your testimony, because then I went back and I was like, okay, I have to find his testimony, because I heard it in like two other, like, if you don't know his testimony, go listen. So I found it and I was like, there's so much similarities here. This is amazing. And it really helps me to add to my testimony, because nobody has heard it said in this way like ever. And so I'm just really grateful for that.
And I love it too, because with your story, like, it will touch so many lives, because I know so many people that have gone through the same thing where something tragic happened in their life, whether it's like parents being separate, which you went through that too with like not really having good parents, and then, or maybe they had some health thing, which then you had that too. So like you said, Satan, he is trying so hard to take you out of this world, like, which he's doing. His job is to steal, kill, and destroy. And that's why I love, like, with your testimony, I think it's Revelation, is it 12:11? Or 11:12? He overcame Satan by the word of the Lamb, or by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. And so, and they did not love their lives as to shrink from death. So it's like, so many times we fear death, we fear pain, and we're learning about that today in 1 Peter, but so many times we want to get out of pain, and right, that's why people do drugs. That's why people have sex, do all this stuff to escape pain. But the only truth, right, we know, and the only peace that we have is in Jesus. So can you tell us a little bit of what it looked like maybe in your high school years, or like when you were in that crowd? And then also kind of, did you get into like New Age law of attraction then, or what did that look like for you?
Yeah, so it was really interesting for me. Magic and witches, my favorite movie was The Wizard of Oz. And then when The Craft came out, I was like, I need to have my own witch group and try all these levitating and Ouija boards and all of these things. So I know that definitely opened up the doorway for demonic activity to happen and for me to be oppressed, because that did happen in my life, just constantly being oppressed, tormented with thoughts. And every time that I would speak to a counselor, they would just say, you know, because I'm like, I'm telling you, I hear things in here, and you don't want to tell somebody that, because
they'll say you're crazy.
We got a special place for you, the little padded room.
Right. And so now I'm convinced, okay, I actually have some type of mental disorder. I need these meds. I have to be on benzodiazepines. I have to be on the antidepressants. Like, I have to be on that because I actually have something wrong with me. So that really numbed out my emotions for a long time, because that's what it does. It numbs you out. It makes you kind of operate in like a robotic type of way. So here I am, a teenager, and because I was still dealing with panic, even though I was on these meds, I stopped going to school because I would have panic attacks just getting to school. So I just stopped going to school, started hanging out more in the crowd that's drugs and sex, found a boyfriend, got pregnant at 16. The very first time, so I'm 16 years old, and that was the first time I ever saw my mom cry, is when I came home from Planned Parenthood with the paper that says, you know, Tracy, positive pregnancy. And then there was a note to my mother saying, like, they have ways to take care of this, right? And my mother looked at me, and I looked at her, and she just started crying. And that was the first time I ever saw my mother cry. Wow. And then she says, okay. Like, she had this complete change of heart, because my mom was a hard, like, you don't need no man. Mm-hmm. You are going to do it this way. This is how we're going to be. You know, just strived. She always worked. She worked hard for food on the table and just showed us that we don't need a man. And that's just how it was. And she told me, like, we're going to take care of this baby. You're not eating hot dogs. I'll never forget. You're not eating hot dogs. You're not scooping the litter boxes anymore. Yeah. You have too many cats, like, you know, all these pregnancy things I had no idea about. But that brought, so that's where me and my mom started to come together again. Because remember, I parted away because I was so mad about my surgery. And so we came together, had a beautiful pregnancy. My boyfriend stayed around. We named her Faith because I always just had this foundation. Somehow I just misplaced it. I was redirecting my faith. So then I had her, and then that was the start of, okay, time to get my act together. I went back for my GED. I saved up for a car. I was working. I went back to college. Graduated, did a really great internship, marketing, business, all the things. I just knew I was going to be at a desk and be my own boss. Like, I knew it was, I didn't even know what entrepreneur was. I just knew that that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to take control of my life. And that's where I'm like, well, if I can control things in my life, then there's got to be another way for this. Well, I ended up getting a really great job opportunity for another entrepreneur. And she was spiritual. And it was the very first rich person I ever met. I walked into her house. It was a mansion, and I loved Beauty and the Beast growing up. And you know how, like, they have the wall of books in, like, this library. She had, like, one of those. I was just, like, memorized by it. But the books were all New Age, like, you have, you know, the power to control your reality, all New Age self-development books. And she said, you take whatever books you want, read them, take them to your house, bring them back, you know, at your leisure. I'm like, okay, I went through those books and I applied everything that I learned in these books. And that is where I was manifesting, law of attraction, the universe, you know, has your back. And then I wanted to get into, like, quantum physics, because I was like, there's this universal power and there's frequencies, and, like, I can get things if I just level up. There's, like, this enlightenment and, like, this hidden knowledge that I can have. And in that time, people just started falling away in my life. So I had my best friend. Her name is Krista. And she knew about God and Jesus. She had some health issues throughout her life. And that, I guess, is what started for her to lean in on the Lord. And she wouldn't necessarily talk about Jesus or bring him up, but she would always just say, you just got to pray about it. You just got to pray about it. And I'm like, yeah, you know, I pray. Like, I talk to the universe. I talk to the trees. Like, I was kind of like a hippie. I would hug trees and stuff and be like, oh, the earth is so great and stuff like that. Well, in that time of me really being enlightened, or so I thought, with these books, there was a conversation I had with her where she said, the things that you're doing and saying are evil, and we just can't hang out anymore. And I'm like, I was so prideful and egotistical. I was like, you are just so stupid. Like, you can't be this smart to understand. Cause, like, I'm on a different energy wave. And so because I'm up here and I'm vibrating higher than you, that's why you don't get it. I was so stupid. Yeah. And so we parted ways. I continued, you know, just excelling in my career. And there was always a tug. I always missed her. I always loved her.
How old are you about right now? When you felt?
I was Yeah. So we fell. So I was, I have to think of time here.
I know. That's my thing. I always go.
Right. I was 28. Okay. I was 27. I'm sorry. I was 27. And then we didn't talk for about 6-7 months during, once we parted. So the Lord always used my dreams, always used my dreams. And when I was little, I used to think that it was just something that they would call deja vu or premonitions. I didn't know that the Lord can speak to us in our dreams and show us things. Like, I thought perhaps this was a psychic ability. I thought I did. I was born to be this spiritual woo person. Because I have like this gift. And so I would have these dreams, and this, there was nothing like this one dream. So just one night, so we bought this beautiful house, and I was just so excited. I wanted to show it off to everyone. My husband and I made he's Catholic. We were married Catholic. We just thought, you know, we were doing very good for ourselves, both excelling in our careers. He was getting a little agitated with me by me saying, like, you can't say stuff like that because you're going to manipulate the reality and it's going to all mess up. Mm. Like, I'm working hard, right? Like, and we would really get into arguments about that because he just thought, like what? Like, mm-hmm. You know, he just wasn't, he wasn't New Age, but he also, he loved me so much. He just kind of let me do my thing in a way, right? So I have this dream. It's completely black. I see nothing. There's nothing there, but there is a voice, and it's from behind me, and I'm not able to turn around. And it's a loving but masculine and stern voice, and the voice said, your friend's name is not well. My spirit or something in me said, something bad, like this means something bad. Like I knew it was something bad. And I woke up, like I tried to turn around in my dream, but I couldn't. And I woke up and I was so shook by this because this was a dream unlike I've ever had. And I woke my husband up and I said, I had this dream about this person, this masculine voice that said this. And he said, well, what are you going to do about it? I said, I have no idea. I said, what do you think I should do about it? And he said, well, why don't you just reach out to her? Like, reach out to your friend, right? Because I wasn't thinking I was going to reach out to her. I'm too good for that. I'm too, like, you know what I mean? Like, I'm too smart. Why would I be the one to come to her first? She, if anything, she owes me an apology because I was that ignorant. Like, so I did. I sent her a message on Facebook and I just said, I love you. I miss you. There, I just needed to say it. I'm like, I love you and I miss you. How are you? And she says, hey, I'm doing really good. How are you? I miss the kids. She was like a second mom to my little ones because she was always around. Like when I had my oldest daughter, she was around and she always helped me a lot. So, and she was one of my roommates. We were really close. And she just said, I miss the kids. I would love to see the new place. I'm doing really good. She said, I started journaling and I'm like, aha, she's getting onto that self-development train. This is why our energies are coming back because she's journaling now. I bet you she's reading, you know, self-development stuff and we're matching back up. I was like, oh, okay. So I thought like the universe in some way was trying to tell me like you guys are now back as like
she's
this.
She's enlightened. She's becoming.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And now we can match on this universal frequency, if you will. And she just said, yeah, I'll come. I would love to see the house. I said, okay, I love you, miss you. She said, love you, miss you. And then 2 weeks later, I get a phone call from her fiance that she went into a coma because her heart just stopped unexpectedly. And I, in that moment, I almost couldn't believe what I was hearing because I had this dream and then that happened.
Yeah.
And I went, okay, what really was this? What, who was this? Why? I had all of these questions. I begged him to let me go to the hospital. It was about 2 hours from where I was because she had to be on life support. I said, please. She said, and he said, no. She made me promise that if anything were to happen to her in this way, because they were together for years, like a decade, if anything were ever to happen like this, that she wouldn't want anyone to see her this way. And so I'm acknowledging that she does not want anyone to see her. I said, I'm telling you, if I come there, I can get her spirit to go. I could get her soul to go back into her body. Like, I was that naive to think that I had control over life and death, that I can get her. If I just went there, I was able to put her soul back into her body because I was able to manipulate and control my life and manifest and have law of attraction. So I could do it with somebody's soul.
Now, Tracy, I don't mean to interrupt. I want to ask this. So when she broke up, kind of broke off the friendship for a little while, was that because of like witchcraft or what, like, just so our list, what was when she said, I can't be around you, the stuff you're doing is evil. Can you give, like, what was a specific thing she was saying? I'm sorry, yeah. I can't do it. Because that's, you know, I'm thinking that 2 Timothy 3:5, they will act in the last days, it says they will act religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly. Stay away from people like that. So she was doing that. She was doing a biblical thing. But like, what was it that she said, that's it? Because she was your good friend, so it must have been hard for her. But what was there specific thing that, you know, I mean, was it witchcraft or was it New Age or both or what?
Yeah, I was trying to open my third eye.
So she's just saying that's not God. But isn't it amazing how you wanted to be spiritual? It's just like, I don't know how to put words in your mouth, but deceived, it was so weird when I found Jesus. It was like, because I was raised Catholic, right? So I'm like, are you telling me Jesus is the answer? I thought it was some New Age, you know, be some kung fu thing, right? Snatch the pebble. It couldn't be Jesus. Are you kidding me? I already done this. I always thought it'd be some Eastern. It had to be something really cool and mystical and weird. But I was like so shocked that I missed you. I mean, you're the answer and I missed you for all those years. So it's pretty wild.
Yeah. So it was me trying to open my third eye, me doing all these weird rituals and things. And she just said, like, I can't have any part of that.
Which is pretty bold because a lot of people don't have the guts to say that in love and say, I love you, but I can't hang with you. So
did her fiance let you, or did he still say no?
He wouldn't let me at all. He was like, no, I'm sorry. This is just the way that it has to be. And I just said, okay. So I'm like, I'm just going to channel to her and I'm going to talk to her soul from my house then. Fine, no problem. I got this power. I'm going to do it from here. So I would do these rituals and I would try to talk to her. I would go into like this deep meditation and try to find her soul. So I'm like be floating and trying to find it to where she's at to tell her like, just go back. It's fine. You're lost, but you're going to be okay. Just go back. You're on life support. You're going to be able to come up. Like, I was fully convinced that I was able to have control and power over what was going to actually happen to her life, fully convinced. And so I got the call. So she was on life support for 14 days. Her fiance told me, Tracy, there's no way. Like, I already know that she's gone. They're going to tell me we're going to have to take her off, but I already know that she's gone. I know it because she fell into his arms in the bathroom and that was it. Yeah. And he said, I just know that this is it. And I would got mad at him. I'm like, how can you just lose your faith? Right. Cause I still had faith, but not faith in the one true God. Yep. Right. And so here I am, I'm in my office. I'm trying to do all these weird rituals and things. And I was just yelling out, like, what's going on? Give me answers. I fall asleep that night. I have another dream. And I almost forget about this dream because I think my subconscious or something just didn't want to remember this one because I felt force in this dream. I didn't feel anything in the first one, but I felt force in this one. Again, it's dark and it's black, and she is in front of me. And we're just walking up these concrete stairs, and there's two railings on each side. And she's walking and in front of me. So she's in front of me. I'm behind her and we're walking up steps and it's just black. And she has some type of force with her. I can't see it. I don't know what it is, but she has something with her. And as she's walking up these stairs, she would take a step onto the stair and it would just crumble and fall. And she would go to the next one, it would crumble and fall. And she'd go to the next one, it would just crumble and fall. And I'm behind her and I'm trying to force her and push her because that's easy for me. I'm just walking up these steps and I'm trying to just push her up the steps. And she, in my dream, she turned around with this magnitude of a force that pushed me back. And I almost couldn't breathe because it was just so overwhelming. And she said, "I'm not going this way." And I woke up and I went, "What is this?" I'm like, what is this? And then a couple days later, again, I'm trying to channel and do all these things, have power. A couple days later, he calls me and said, "That's it. Like, you know, we took her off life support. She's gone." Da da da. And I'm now I'm broken. Now I'm totally, fully broken. In such a beautiful way. I got down on my face for the first time. And I surrendered all of my anger, my wrath, my control. I didn't want any of it. Thank you, Jesus. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And I just got on my face and I yelled out to every single false god that I knew, right? So I yelled out to that false god. To this one that I knew about in charge of yoga, or this one for astrology, like this one for all of these different gods. And I said, "Whoever you are," right? And then before I went on to my sentence, I said, "Even Jesus," I added Jesus. I said, "Whoever you are, reveal yourself to me. I'm seeking you. I want to know who you are. Who were you in my dream? Who are you? Tell me. I will dedicate my life and I will never stop talking about you."
Praise God.
Amen.
That's so cool.
Love that.
And I didn't hear anything. So I'm like, okay, nothing happened. I don't know what's going on, whatever. You know, life continues. Maybe a week or so later, her fiance comes to my house. And he brings me some of her things. He says, "She just wanted you to have everything, left everything for you." I'm like, okay. So like, I literally have all of her things, her entire everything. And he puts her journal next to me on the couch. And he says, "I want you to read this." And I was like, I can't read that. And because like, I'm just so broken. Like I'm still like just sitting, like, I can't believe that I couldn't, like, I'm just broken. I'm lost. I can't believe my best friend is gone. Everything that I thought that I could like control or have power, I don't, because like I have nothing. And he's like, "Can you just open the journal and read it?" And I'm like, okay, fine. But I'm only going to the last page. I just want to see the very last thing that she wrote. So I go to the last page and it's dated the date that I reached out to her on Facebook. So I was like, okay. And there's just one verse there. It was John 14:6. Amen. "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except by me."
Amen.
And the sun is shining on my face right now. I closed the journal and my husband said, "Are you okay?" And I guess maybe I had a look on my face like, God is speaking to me. Cool. Something's going on. And this is my first grieving experience. So, you know, everyone's just taking it like, "Oh, this is just how she's grieving. She'll be okay. Like, she's not really hearing anything. Like, she's fine. Don't worry. Mommy's okay." Because I'm like, Jesus is real. I'm telling you, Jesus is real. Like I just went radical. Like I just went on fire for the Lord, because I just knew there was no wavering doubt from that moment. I'm just like, thank you, thank you, thank you. And then days would go like day, and then he says, "Oh, I put a few things in your trunk," before he left. I'm like, okay. And so now I'm like, the only thing that I know how to do from anything is just pray. So I'm just praying and I'm like, God, show me what I do next. Like, I know it's you. I'm here. I dedicate my life to you. Just show me what to do next. I don't know. Like, I just need to know. And there was no one around me who was a Christian or that could guide me or help me or anything. And I would try to search. And then some of the people that I would find were just like, I felt like they were very judgmental. Like there wasn't love. There was a lot of religious folks out there, but nobody willing to embrace the brokenness that I had and all these questions that I had, because I had so many questions. Like, and then I remember, so I heard his voice. It was a few weeks after that incident, to check my trunk. And I'm like, what is in my, what? Like, oh, I know, I remember that. Like, this is it again. You know, like, there's something here. So I run out to my trunk. He put her Bible in my trunk. It was just her Bible. And I went, oh my gosh. And I opened it. And there was just in the beginning, like right when you open it, she just had Psalms. I have it right here. I don't remember exactly what it is. It's in the Psalms, and it says, and then I tried to flip. I don't even know how to find Psalms.
You don't know how to work a Bible.
Are these chapters, numbers? Like, you know, it took me a little while to finally find what it was that she had highlighted, just this one thing. And it was, my words are a lamp to your feet. Like, I will guide your way. And I went, so now I read this, and this is going to guide me, and this is going to tell me everything that I got. And I, that's just, that's it. Like, mm-hmm. I've just been on fire for the Lord. From that moment, I knew that I can hear God and that he was speaking to me, the more that I would seek him. And everyone just thought, especially my husband, that I was going crazy, like really crazy.
She's hearing voices again.
Seriously. Yeah. And that is the God's honest truth. There was talk about putting me in a mental institution. Wow. He even talked to my mother about it, because that was, they were like, this is her breaking point. Like, they knew about my past and the PTSD and the meds and this and that. And now she's really hearing from God. Oh, so now you wait until I hear from God to put me in a mental institution. Yeah. But not when I'm hearing from demons. Like, come on, right? Because I'm like, I want to transform life. I don't want to smoke weed anymore. I want to be like completely transformed. How does this work? And so as I was growing closer to God, I was growing further away from my husband. And so that was the very first thing that God worked in my life was
now he was, you said he was Catholic, right? He would say he was religious, but of course didn't have a relationship. So he would claim to be a Catholic at that time. Okay.
Yep. The kids were, you know, baptized the way that they do it. Very, old school traditional Catholic family.
Yeah.
And this was the first thing like that God really did in my life, because I was like, God, if you saved me, you can save my husband, right? Mm-hmm. And so I'm like, what do I do? What do I do? And then, like, you know how God just works in such amazing ways? There was this thing that came up on my TV about this movie called The Case for Christ. Yeah. And it was about, you saw that movie? And she prayed this prayer in that movie about turning her husband's heart of stone to a heart of flesh. And I was like, that's it. So I'd go in my closet and I would pray it over and over and over. And I kid you not, it was shy of 14 days. He calls me from work crying, crying. And he was like, you aren't going to believe this. And I was like, yes, I will. Yes, I will. But tell me. And then he has his own testimony. And I'm going to save that because that's his to tell. But it was just beautiful. God worked in his life as well. And so he saved us. And then, you know, and I think that's why I resonated so much with you and your family, because it helps us to see how to do it right. Like, we want to raise our kids in the way to follow the Lord and not the world. And when I was talking to Mariah, the way that she was raised, right? Because I'm like, well, how did your, I would ask her all these questions on how.
Dude, that's really what he says.
Like, you know, because my daughter just had the point where she's like, you got to trust me. You know, she's almost 16. You got to trust me. Da, da, da. And I'm just like, no. So I'd say to Mariah, you know, how do you guys navigate that? And one thing that she said to me, she was like, well, my dad was always very open and honest with us. And he would say, I can't even trust myself. Yeah. Like, our hearts are deceitful and this or that. And I'm like, yes, like, God is always working. And so he's just now working through us to, like, parent and steward a fellowship correctly, parent godly, have a more godly marriage. And it's just, it's been beautiful. Of course, there's been trials and struggles throughout that, because, you know, we go through that process of that sanctification process, if you will. But just overall, like, I would do it again and again, all over again. Amen. All over. And I would, again, I'd never stop talking about him. So here I am years later. And yes, of course, I still struggle with different things. But he is not just my Savior, he is my Lord. He's my Lord.
That's the key.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's I love that, is that, you know, we used to say in the hippie movement, the Jesus movement, you know, when all the hippies got saved with Calvary Chapel, but they said, Jesus loves you just the way you are, but he loves you so much, he's not going to leave this way. And that's the part, I think people have kind of forgotten that part. You know, it's like, oh, he just loves me, I can do whatever. And it's like, no, he loves you, but he's always trying to move you towards being like him and walking in truth. And I love that, like you said about that. It's like, you know, the old saying, you can't scam a former scammer. So it's like, you know what I mean? You give me an inch, I'll take a mile of my flesh. And so it's like, I always told my kids, you know, I love his parents. They say, oh, I let my daughter or my son alone in the bedroom with her boyfriend, and I trust them. And it's like, it's like saying, I trust my dog to have a steak on the table and he won't eat it. I mean, it's like, come on. I mean, you know, that's part of that new age, you know, hippie. Yeah. Everyone's good. You know, it's like, no,
right.
I mean, we have a sinful nature. I mean, it's like, you know, the only thing, I love what Paul says, in me, that is my flesh, dwells no good thing. The only good thing in us is Jesus, and that's what we have to just realize. So it's not like we're just trying to always beat ourselves and condemn ourselves. We're just saying, apart from Christ, as Jesus said, apart from me, you can do nothing. And that's what I just say is, like, it's like, as a pastor, I always say it, you know, kind of like Paul in 2 Corinthians 12, where he says, when I'm weak, then I'm strong. And so I say, like, for me, I know I could commit adultery given the right circumstance. So therefore, I'm not alone with any woman except my daughters and my wife. And people say, what is your problem? And it's like, it's not a problem. It's just, I don't want to have a problem. So therefore, as the Bible says, give no opportunity for the flesh, you know, flee youthful lust. And people have a hard time with that. I've had people leave the church because of, but it's like, by the grace of God, I have never committed adultery in my life. You know, I used to be very sexually moron. I even struggled in Christ, you know, but it's like, I don't do that now because I don't give it. Yeah. So it's not that I'm now super strong now. I mean, I hopefully I'm a little stronger, but the thing I realize is I don't have confidence in myself apart from God. And I feel like Joseph, you know, when he dropped his coat and ran, you know, it's like, you just got to get out of stuff and flee it. And you know that as a parent, it's really hard, you know, because you want to be in this world, but not of this world. And that's such a hard balance, right? Because we do want to have effect. But I like how David Guzik, Calvary guy, said, we have to sail our boat in this worldly waters, but we hopefully don't let the water get in our boat. And that's the key. So that's cool. Yeah. I'm proud of you for that. Yeah, because, I mean, and kids, you know, they're going to fight you on that. Don't you trust me? It's like, if I don't trust myself and I'm 58 years old, I'm pretty sure I'm not going to trust a hormonal 15-year-old. You know what I mean? It's like, and, you know, it's not cool to people, but God isn't about being cool. He's about being truthful and honest and real.
And you'll be, like, rejected in people because you probably lost a lot of your friends, like, who were into that, because a lot of people, that's the hard thing, is when they come into Christ. I kind of want you to share a little bit of that too, what it was like, because we have a lot of people in our church, you know, who are in the new age and then come to Christ, but then they get really excited, but then you start to realize they don't count the cost of, hey, it's not going to be all sunshine, roses, and butterflies. There's going to be hardship and there's going to be trials. And so I just want to read this verse. It is in Psalm 119. I think this might be the one that your friend had in her Bible, but it's Psalm 119, starting in verse 9, it says, how can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to your word. With my whole heart I seek you. Let me not wander from your commandments. Verse 11, I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. And then it goes on talking about how we delight in his statutes and we will not forget his word. And that's what's so important, is like when you got the word of God, because people can go based off dreams and feelings, but unless we have the word of God as our foundation, you can totally be deceived, and even in Christ. And so that's where you obviously were deceived when you were in the new age and law of attraction. But can you share a little bit of how
Can I say one thing on that? I want to say this real quick. I think it's Ezekiel 28 or 23, but it says, because it's funny, someone had said, I had a dream, and you know, dreams can be good, but dreams can also be bad. And I love how, I think it's, I forget what it is. We can put it maybe in the footnotes. But it says, he says, what is, a prophet might have a dream, let him tell his dream, but basically, and I'm paraphrasing, what is a dream compared to the wheat of the word? And that's the key, is like, you know, as long as your dream matches up with scripture, yay, good. But sometimes people have, like, I had this one person tell me, an angel told me at the foot of my bed, he woke me up in the middle of the night and told me that this God was going to kill this person's wife and I was going to marry him. And I'm like, well, okay. She goes, I saw it. I go, I believe you. I don't question that. I believe in the supernatural, but I believe that was an angel of light disguised himself. And I said, because God would not kill someone for you to marry them. That is not God's way. And so, and we have to really differentiate between that, right? Is that dreams are great as long as they go along with the word. But if a dream contradicts the word or someone has a prophetic word that goes against the word, we have to say, whoa, God's Holy Spirit will never contradict the word of God. Yeah. God holds his word. Yeah. So.
It's in Jeremiah 23:28.
I said Ezekiel. I was way off. Sorry.
Jeremiah 23:28. It says, let the prophet who has a dream tell the dream, but let him who has my word speak the word faithfully. What has straw in common with wheat, declares the Lord. So it's like chaff compared to the wheat of the word. But God, that's the.
And
cool
we're not
thing
saying about
like,
your dream, but we're just saying when people, because sometimes we'll have people say, I had a dream, and I'm like, okay, but does
but
it match the
match,
word of
they
God?
Don't bring it
is
back
it
to the word?
You know, because some people have these crazy dreams that are, you know, new like New Age. That's how we distinguish it between a dream of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. And a New Age dream is based on, does it agree with Scripture? Does it align with Scripture? Because if it's God, it's going to, God will never go against his word. And we have people say that because, you know, I mean, you were spiritual before you were Christian, but it was the wrong spirit, right? We only believe in two power sources. It's either demonic or God. And, you know, God, Satan comes in many forms, but Jesus is the, like you said, John 14:6, he's the only way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father except through him. And that's it. We have to know that. But people say, like I talk to this guy, I say, I believe in Jesus and I believe in chi. And I go, well, no, the only power is the Holy Spirit that's good. I said, there's no chi. You can't. He goes, well, but I think that's the Holy Spirit. No, it's the Holy Spirit. But he argues that. It's just hard. Yeah. You know better than me dealing with that. But can you share maybe this? Okay, go.
Oh, yeah. So just maybe share some like things and tips for like, or not tips, but just some, maybe even like what God was speaking to you and how he helped like sanctify you and get you through that
and the struggles
time.
Maybe of doing, because I think, you know, that's the thing, Tracy, is that like we were talking off camera, is that, you know, we don't want this to be like a national choir, but we want to say that, that, you know, to kind of help people, you know, because I try to be very candid. Sometimes people get mad at me, man, I don't want to know this about my pastor, but I try not to glorify sin. But I try to say I am a human and I still have a flesh and I still struggle. And it's only by the grace and strength of God that I'm different.
Yep.
And it's when I love what A.W. Tozer said, as long as we keep falling forward, you know, as long as we keep being broken before God like you were, that's, I love that when you said, I just was at the end of myself, my power didn't work. And you're like, okay, what is it? And that's what we have to do, everything. You know, right? When you struggle with an issue, even in Christ, you have to just go, I'm done. I can't do this. You've got to do this. And that's all God really wants from us, is just to come to the end of ourselves so that we can cry out for his help. And, you know, and I think that, you know, it says you have not because you ask not. But, you know, sometimes we ask with wrong motives. But hopefully our motive, I know, right, God's going to want to sanctify us if we sincerely say, I don't want this. And can you share maybe, if you've, Lord willing, share some, maybe some struggles that, because you said, I saw in your testimony, you said the first year was pretty intense, lost friends. Can, what do you feel? That, I mean, take your liberty,
I
guess.
So I think the hardest thing was once I lost my best friend, I would just gravitate towards anyone who wanted to be a friend. And I didn't know that bad company corrupts good character. I didn't know that. So I was still influenced through different people that I would hang out with. So I was told that marijuana was biblical. I was told that crystals were biblical. You know, I was told that law of attraction was a biblical concept because, you know, you speak life and death. And so, like, you can speak reality. So people would tell me that I was hanging around with, they were Christian New Agers, that you kind of can do both and have both because that is what it is. But, like, I was fully convicted, though. Like, I just knew, but I wasn't fully convicted on marijuana. And the reason being, I feel as if I thought when the Bible says, like, I've given you every bearing fruit and seed, right? And
herbs.
I was already using essential oils because, like I said, I was, like, hippie-ish. And so I'm like, oh, you know, whatever I need from the earth that's going to be supplied to me. So I'm like, oh, so cannabis is fine. And remember, I told you I was addicted to Percocets at age 13. So I was 13 when I had my surgery, 13. And I was able to come off of opiates because of cannabis. Mm-hmm. So I thought, oh, it's okay. But what I didn't realize is that like cannabis was an idol, like a lord of mine. I spent a lot of my money on it. I thought about it a lot. I always wanted to get high. I thought I needed to be high to do this, that, you know, and I was just very deceived about that. So I struggled for about a year in still getting high off marijuana. And nobody really knew that because I'm like, oh, I'm a Christian and now I'm smoking weed. I can't like let people know that. Mm. So I would really hide that. And I remember the one time, because I was praying to God, like, help me hate the things that you hate, like show me and help me hate the things that you hate. Cause I'm just like all in, I didn't care what it was.
Yeah. And so Tracy, let me ask this. So you were told it's sort of cool by sort of new age Christians or kind of pseudo Christians, but yet you knew in your spirit though, the Holy Spirit was sort of saying, this is not cool. So you kind of, even though you were trying to justify it, you knew deep in your heart that it wasn't right.
So. Yeah, it seemed like there was always like this battle in my mind, you know. But I'll never forget the moment where I smoked too much. So somebody gave me it was oil to put in a vape pen, and I smoked too much, and I was so high that I felt like I couldn't even breathe because it was so high. It even felt like hard in my chest, and I was starting to get really paranoid. And I went into my back bathroom and I cried out to the Lord and I said, I know, this is okay. Like, and I got it. And I just surrendered again. And I got in my face. I said, you've done it before. You've done it again. And I don't even remember exactly everything that I was praying, but I remember my husband came in and he just looked and he's like, are you okay? And I sat up and I was no longer high. I was just no longer high. And from that day forward, I haven't touched it.
Praise God.
You didn't remember, I don't know if you remember my testimony, but it's so cool. Right when I was hearing about Jesus and I was there at the rock block and all of a sudden, you know, I said, I'm not going to do weed. My friends, they're all Catholic. They say, oh, you're blanking Jesus. Yeah. And they're all hypocrites. And I'm only 18. And all of a sudden they put they put this red hair sesame in, put it in the microwave. It was just right off the bud. And they put it in. And all of a sudden the goes around. I go, no, dude, I don't want to smoke, get high anymore. And all of a sudden my hand goes, well, I do. It was kind of like, it felt like I was outside myself and I just got high. And all of a sudden my friend, who's supposed to be a Christian now, I haven't talked to him, haven't been able to get a hold of him. But he said he just saw death come upon me. Mm-hmm. Like I go, I can't even do Jesus right. And so, and I mean, and I just, I maybe if you can talk about that, what you, your thoughts are. But I mean, I just feel, you know, pharmakia, I don't know if you know this, but sorcery, where it says the flesh, the works of the flesh in Galatians 5. But the word sorcery is pharmakia.
Yep.
And where I really believe drugs open you up, whether you're wanting to or not, right? They open you up to the demonic. That's what we were saying off camera about when you get that paranoia.
Yeah.
I really believe that's the first time you get high, that paranoia is demonic. And then for me, I don't know if you can relate, but I smoked weed so much that if I wasn't high, I started to feel high. I started to freak out. I had to be high. I had a bong by my bed because it was just like, it was not just an idol. It was my crutch. I could not function if I wasn't at least buzzed. And so, you know, can you share? I mean, so God, but it was neat like you. So then I said, I heard this rock block of Joe English, the guy from Paul McCartney Wings, the Beatles guy. And he goes, I've had women, I've had drugs, I've had everything, but Jesus is real. And I'm like, I just stood up and I go, see, you can be a Christian to be cool. And then all of a sudden the high left and I ran home. I was smoking so much dope that my lungs ran like 3 miles home, but I was crying. I was just saying, God, like you, I just said, Lord, I don't know what this is, but whatever, you know, I know Jesus, you're real and I'll do whatever you want. And like you, you know what I mean? But can you share? Because it's like me, like you, that IV was radical. God delivered me from a lot of stuff, drugs, sexual morality. But, you know, still some of, like, for me, the anger was a struggle for a long time. Just, and weird thing for me, I don't know, you know, but my struggle, everyone swelled because my whole family was alcoholic, both sides. So I always thought when things got really bad as a Christian, like, you know, kind of like your thing with weed, I would drink every once in a while, you know, hidden. I would never drink socially, but I'd drink. And so that took a while before I just said no drinking whatsoever. And I didn't drink socially, but I would just kind of have that crutch. And so, you know, can you know, just how, so you just did that and it was done that time, or did it take
some?
How cool.
Yep. No, I was fully convicted. Once I got up and I was completely sober. I was no longer high. That power, the feeling of the Holy Spirit, like that power, I'm just like, Like, I want to serve you. I want to just give my entire life, anything that is wicked, anything that is not of you, anything that is an idol over my life, just have it fall away. Show me. Like, and so he would show me, and there were some things where I thought I could give up and I would try. So one example I will say, and I'm not a medical professional, I'm not going to tell anybody to stop taking their antidepressants or anything of that sort. So you know that I told you about benzodiazepines. That's your Klonopin, your Xanax, your Valium. Those are to like instantly take away a panic attack. Mm. Well, the Lord showed me that they were giving me more panic attacks than what I had already had. And so I was radical, right? And I was like, okay, I'm going to be completely done with these. And I was completely done with them. And 2 days later, I started having seizure after seizure after seizure. Mm. I didn't know that my body was addicted to a Xanax. I had no idea that a benzodiazepine had that, but I knew that my God was greater. I just knew that I would be okay. I did have to end up going into a lot of testing. I had an MRI. It showed that I had a brain injury, which I told my doctor it was from me just bluntly stop taking these medications. And he was like, no, that's not possible. You must have hit your head. I was like, I didn't hit my head. Hmm. Like, he's like, oh, then maybe you had a headache the time. I'm like, no, I didn't have a headache. I didn't hit my head. I know that this is from me just bluntly stopping taking my meds. And so the Lord was ministering to me, showing me that what needed to fall away, but to do it in a way that would be smart, like wise. Exactly. So I'm like, okay, right? So I'm like, okay, how do I do this that's wise? I knew about pharmakia. I'm like, I don't want to be opening myself up. But I went, so praise God, I was at 3 milligrams. For anyone who's struggling, just know that it is possible. There are people out there that will help you get off of benzodiazepines. There's a tapering and a withdrawal process. It takes time. Don't be ashamed. It's totally fine. Mm-hmm. The withdrawal does not last long. I am down to a 0.12 microgram. Mm-hmm. It is absolutely possible. But we just have to do it in a smart way. And I believe that God has given people talents and skills, and I believe that he works through doctors. I believe that he really, truly does. I'm not like anti-doctor. We're not going to get into vaccinations or anything of that sort.
That could be a whole other show.
Well, we're not going to go there. But as far as, because the mental health, right? Like there is a lot with this mental health and the PTSD and all these different diagnoses. And so my struggle is mental health. My struggle is anxiety and panic disorder. And I realized that the more that I'm open about it and the more that I speak about it, the more people are like, well, I want to hear more about that. Like, what else? Like, who is that Jesus that you lean on, right? Because Jesus showed me, because I was like, God, please, if I have this much faith, then why do I still struggle with fear? Mm. What am I fearing? You didn't give me a spirit of fear, right? So I would go back and forth. I'm like, help me learn, help me learn. And God showed me that the opposite of fear was peace. And so I would start meditating, renewing my mind on his word, right? Because our emotions will come from a thought. So we have our thoughts that contribute our emotions, which then contribute our behaviors. And if we have these thoughts that are contributing a behavior, our brain doesn't know what's real and what's not real. So then we're putting ourselves into a panic attack, right? So it really starts with like the renewal of our minds. And that comes through knowing scripture, God's promises. And the more that you know his character and how he's always there for you, you truly have this newfound faith that you can go to rather than the habit of, I need to take a chill pill, because chill pills, around my age, so I'm going to be 33, chill pills are like, they're just normal. Take a chill pill. Yeah. It's like a normal thing. And I know that people don't realize how hard it actually is not to take those chill pills.
Amen. I want to ask you this and see what you think. I got to try to phrase this quickly. But we deal with people, you know, because that struggle with depression and have things. I really like, you know, like we were saying earlier, that you can't scam a former scammer or somebody who's gone through it. But it's like with me, you know, I've been diagnosed everything you can imagine. I didn't take much drugs just because I felt I did enough drugs for 4 lifetimes, so I didn't need to do any more drugs. So I never got on anything. I mean, I was on Ritalin as a kid. I didn't really do antidepressants, you know, and but I just, for me, like you said, weed was kind of my Ritalin. Yeah. It sort of made me normal. I was ADD. And so, but the thing I want to say is that I like what Jordan Peterson, you heard of Jordan Peterson, he's the psychologist. Steven likes him, but he's a secular guy, But he says really practical things. But he says very few people, he says, and people, the world hates him, but says very few people really struggle with clinical depression. You know, like they're chemically imbalanced. He says what a lot of it, he says, I'm not saying there isn't, but he says what we call clinical depression or chemical imbalances, a lot of it's just we've heaped on a lot of bad things, you know, bad relationships, don't have a job, living in my mom's basement, you know, just constantly. And then we wonder, he says, it's kind of like a balloon. You keep putting so much weight on it, it's going to explode. And he was saying how I just say, and it's kind of funny, he says, I just say, start simple. And this is non-Christian. I just say, make your bed, you know, get a job, you know. And it's amazing how we have people, you know, when you're in that, and it's kind of like, you get like when I was kind of hippie, new agey, you're so self introspective that you go, I can't do those practical things. I got to just get into myself and figure out. But you know, it's like I forget the old saying, you know, look to self to be depressed, look to God be blessed. Anyway, it's kind of like, you know, you're not going to find the answer in yourself. The answer is Jesus. And to also, as Jesus said, be an effectual doer. And I'm not saying like you, I think it's very wise when we say that if you're on some antidepressants, go meet with your medical professional and work with him to get off. But sometimes, right, would you agree, we just got to take, you know, you being an entrepreneur, we got to have some things that are positive in our life too, besides the Lord, like get a job, have a purpose, don't sit at home, don't be watching Oprah all day, I mean, or whatever it is, I don't even know, watch TV. But, you know, but we have to do things that are really going to edify and build us up, you know what I mean? Be at church. I think another thing, a lot of people don't go to church, and that's why there's a reason why God says don't forsake the fellowship with other believers, which is going to be
especially the day the Lord is coming, because it's getting darker. Like we know that
COVID,
like,
people are afraid, you know.
Yeah. But, so can you share a little bit, because I want you to also share about your podcast and what you do and how you're, before you were like a life coach for kind of new age things, and how now you have brought that for Christians.
Yeah. One last thing that I want to say on my struggle with mental health and anxiety is I really do believe that a lot of it, if not most of it, not just from what I went through as a child, but was oppression from opening myself up to these demonic things that I had no idea, right? So I just want to say that, because some people think, oh, I actually need meds, when really you need deliverance. Right. And I'm just going to say it the way that was.
And I love what you said, Tracy, is that so good, because I thought of the verse Hebrews 12, 15, because you said the first thing you really notice is rage, because you're so mad, where it says, see to it that no one misses the grace of God. You didn't know Christ, so of course you missed the grace of God, and that there no bitter root grows up to cause trouble and defile many. So you know that, right? Probably doing deliverance or being when we have unforgiveness, we have bitterness. Nothing is like chum to demonic than bitterness and anger and unforgiveness. And that's why maybe you could talk on that real quick, is how it's so important to forgive. And like you said, you were mad at your mom when really your mom was trying to help you. So it was really a misunderstanding. Yeah. But those who have been abused, maybe sexually or physically, but it's so important. I forget who it was. I think it was Booker T. Washington said, I'll give no man the power over my life to make me hate him. Mm. And when we think, oh, I hate someone, I'm hurting them, really we're drinking the poison, hoping it hurts them. And we really need to deal with that, because that gives such place, unforgiveness, bitterness, anger, gives, as we know, Ephesians 4:27, don't give into anger, which gives the devil a mighty foothold, right? And that's what we believe is oppression, not possession, right? You're sealed with the Spirit, but you can get a monkey when we walk in these things of unforgiveness. You know, I know so many Christians, oh, I love Jesus, but I can't forgive. Mm-hmm. Well, what does it say in Ephesians 4:32? Forgive others just as God through Christ has forgiven you. So forgiven people need to be forgiving people, even though it's hard. And sometimes I think people believe the lie that if I forgive somebody, like if they sexually assaulted me, then I'm condoning it. No, God's going to be the judge. God says he's going to avenge. But we have to say, just as I've been so graciously, mercifully forgiven by Jesus, which we all have, if we're honest, then I need to show that same mercy to others. And could you maybe say what you think about that? But I think that's probably where the start of your oppression came, right?
Yeah, I think that you just nailed it. I think everything that you said was straight on. Cool. That's exactly it.
Just forget.
Yeah.
So can you share a little bit of...
Thanks, Tracy, for being the one person that thinks I have something good to say. No, good. Bless you. No. And I don't have to pay you for it. That's so cool.
That's the Holy Spirit. So can you share a little bit now of what you're doing and as like a life coach and what that looks like and some, you know, advice you would give to people and where they can find you and all that stuff too?
Yeah, so I work specifically with ex-New Age entrepreneurs. A lot of the times I'm seeing that they are younger millennials. They get into the digital world and they want to be an entrepreneur. But the business coaches that are out there are using law of attraction, manifestation, look at my life, be an influencer, have what I have, buy what I have, and, you know, just this worldly way of success. So I used all of my past experience to become just a Christian business coach for ex-New Age entrepreneurs. And then I had the podcast Faith to Freedom, where I talk about all things New Age, debunking the New Age tactics of marketing and, you know, all different things. It's not just in marketing, right? Because it really is in self-development. When people are looking to better themselves, they go to a self-development book. And I feel like the world is really just saturated with I had so many people come to me and be like, what's your number one recommendation for a Christian mindset book? And I'm like,
the Bible.
Right? Like, yeah. It's the Bible. There's not one, but everyone's just like seeking for that answer of what it is. And, so I just use Faith to Freedom, the podcast, just to really bring awareness around New Age. Cause so many people, I did a poll over on my Instagram. So many people didn't even know what New Age was before they got into New Age. Yeah. And I was one of those people. Yeah. I had no idea.
Yep. And there's so many people who are Christians and they don't realize they're like listening to these people or looking at these YouTubers in their lives and influencers or reading these books like Jesus Calling and all this stuff. And they have these little messages of New Age. Really, all it is self. It's right. It's all the kingdom of Satan, we always say, is the kingdom of self. We can't just say, oh, I don't follow Satan. But if you're living for yourself, and that's why if we do another episode with you, we really want to talk about money and how money isn't bad in itself, but the love and the when you make it an idol. And it was actually funny. We talked about that last night in our service, and we were talking about how so many times in life, like, people are like, Christians, like, why does the church want all your money? Why does it say to give? And like, that doesn't make sense. And it's like, it's not because a church or that needs your money. It's showing that you surrender to God. Like, God, I trust you. Like, this, I don't want this to have like reign in my life. And so can you share maybe just a little bit about that? Something, just a little, like a little snippet of like that with money and some advice that people might have. Cause we want to have another episode with that. And then, I'll
say
another question afterwards, but that's it.
We like to stack it up. That's great.
I just want to say I love your heart, Mariah. I truly do. You have so much truth. You speak so much truth, and you speak it in a way that is so graceful. And I just want to say that that's needed. When I see millennials speak about follow your dreams, follow your heart, do it this way, I'm like, this is so deceiving. It's really truly sad. And then they're trying to gain success the way that they see these influencers all over Instagram, and because they believe that that's just the way, right? And like, there's a different success. It's for the kingdom. We're not here to glorify ourselves. We're here to point others to Christ. And we can do that as an entrepreneur. We can do that in our work. Like, and there's just a godly way to do it. So one of the things I like to talk about is marketing manipulation. So many people out there will just go and rent a boat or rent a house and go and take pictures. Like, there's entrepreneurial rich secrets that people don't tell, because I used to do it because you would make yourself seem rich. And then people are like, oh, I need to hire that person because I got to be rich and like them. When it's like, no, that was just a background, you know, like that was Photoshop. And it's, you know, there's lying and manipulating. So like, there is truly a godly way to do business. There's a godly way to earn money, make profit. And the more that you earn, you don't enhance and upgrade your lifestyle. It's, you have more to give. And I love your sermon that you guys did on tithing, because you really tied it in together about, it's not for the church, it's about for you, and it's for you to give, and how you brought it all back to scripture. I just want to say, I absolutely love that. But a little bit on money, which I think you've already said, is it is the love of money. If money is your Lord, then yeah, there's a problem there. If all you, I like to say this, what do you think more about in life? So when a young entrepreneur comes to me and they're like, yes, I want to start a business. And I'm like, okay, great. You know, and they're a Christian and they want to do it a godly way. Well, what do you think more about, God or money? Yeah. And they're like, like, come on now. Yeah. Yeah. So you got to be real. Yeah. Right. And if you're not being honest, that's fine. But God already knows your heart. Right. Like so many people come to me and they're like, oh, my service isn't selling. Okay, well, what are you selling? It's like not rocket science, really, because it's the service was built for them, their self, what they wanted to do, not what they needed to create for other people on what other people wanted. Like, and so it's working with the servant's heart. The Bible says a lot about that, the way that you can earn a profit. And I really like the parable with the three talents, right? Because so many people, when I was open with my testimony and I would talk about being an entrepreneur and being a business coach and charging, I had so many people come at me. Like, I had somebody, I'll never forget it, on my testimonial video say, I wonder who the Jesus was that you met, because you're supposed to lift up your cross and, oh, here's my cat. You're supposed to lift up your cross and sell all your things to follow Jesus. And I'm like, and I was a young baby Christian. I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm not supposed to work. I'm not supposed to do this. I'm not supposed to, like, I really thought that, you know, coming out of the New Age, I will say that it's super important that you find a church that understands, right? A church that's not practicing New Age, because there's a lot of New Age in the church now, Enneagram and everything, hello. Yep. But we need to really be using discernment. If you don't have discernment, just pray to God and ask for wisdom, because the Bible tells us, if you come to me, I don't know what verse it is.
Yes, thank you. Let him ask.
Yeah. You know, and really going to the Father and asking him for wisdom, and he will guide you. Let him guide you. And he could do the same thing for people who are in business, because they're like, how do I partner with God in business? Ask him. Yeah. He will show you. It's not about you and gain, gain, gain. And if that's why you're in business, then you shouldn't be in business, because that's just not how it's supposed to be.
And I really like it. Like I was saying, one of the, you know, I was saying last night, I don't know if you were watching, but it's, I was saying how most rich people that I meet, I always joke, I chase a lot of rich people out of our church. But what I don't like is the quid pro quo, where they say, I'll give this, but you got to let me be an elder, or you got to do this. And I say, hey, you give unto the Lord. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it's not that I don't like cheerful, successful really. Business people like yourself. I just don't like the strings. And I never forget this guy. His name's George Meal. And he was one of the richest, probably worth this back when I knew him in the 80s, probably 87. He was worth like $850 million. So pretty rich guy. And but he just loved to give. I mean, when he died, Bush Sr. was there. James Dobson, all these Christians, because he would give millions of dollars away, and just, he saw that was his ministry. So he made a lot of money and he lived a nice life. You know, I didn't know who he was. It's funny. It was really cool. This is what I love when you're rich and you don't show it.
Yeah, but
So I'm hanging out with this guy. We're going to pray for a sick friend of his, and I don't even know who the guy is. And so my pastor, when I was at this church, I was the assistant pastor, he goes, go pray with George Meal. Don't know who George Meal is. I just came to the church. And he goes, and he's in a Lexus, but it wasn't like anything really crazy. And so we go, and all of a sudden people go, so how was your time with George Meal? And I go, yeah, it's good. I just prayed, you know, and then it's like, cool. And then he goes, oh, and that was it. And then that Tuesday, they go, why don't you clear the field? Because we're going to have an elders meeting and you just need to clear the field. And there's a school there. And I go, clear the field? What do you mean? So all of a sudden, he lands his helicopter into the thing. I'm like, oh my, wow. Yeah, this guy, I think, might have some money. But anyway, but he was so cool. And his whole ministry was to give money. Like, I guarantee you, if he was alive right now, our church would be totally paid off. That's just the way he was. And I think, what a cool thing. You know what I mean? Because I've never really made a lot of money since I've been a pastor, but as a drug dealer, I had lots of money. But but you know, what a cool thing if you really can see you're blessed to be a blessing.
Amen.
What a cool thing. But like, I said last night, people say, well, I don't love money. I just love the stuff money gives. And I go, yeah, but then that's covetousness. I mean, so it's not that you can't have nice stuff, but if that's all you're thinking about, you know, I always love it when people say, oh, you know, I can't come to church because I have to fix my beach house or whatever. It's like, well, maybe you shouldn't always be, maybe there's too much, you know, be careful, because, you know, I mean, God, sorry to be blessed, but make sure it doesn't, like you said, the blessings don't get a hold of you. You know, they don't, you know, what does it say? You use wealth. Wealth doesn't use you. You know what I mean? Or so what does it say? We love people and use wealth. We don't use or love wealth and use people. You know, that's the key. And I see if you use it to serve others and bless the work of God, then money is a great thing because we really need it. I mean, it's hard. You know, everyone could be all spiritual, but if we don't get our, if we don't have money, then we don't get to pay the bills and there won't be a church. And so it's a fine balance, you know what I mean? So
Tracy, I know we are past our time, but do you have anything
kids
else?
Kids are scratching at the door. Let me in, mommy.
Is there anything else you would like to share?
You saw my cat. She's like, hello, dinner time.
Dinner time. We're all hungry. Is there anything else you'd like to share with our listeners?
I would just like to say that if you're fresh, new out of the New Age movement, it's going to be crucial that you do an audit of the things that you're consuming in your mind. This goes down to the people that you follow on Instagram. So a lot of people who come out of the New Age end up going back. They're being led back astray, or they have one foot in and one foot in. So you're either all in Jesus is Lord, or you're not. There's no in between in a way that can help you, because it feels really lonely. It feels totally lonely in that transition because you just feel lost. There's really no way to navigate, especially if you don't know how to even read a Bible. I remember like just going through that. And one of the things that the Lord showed me was I had to be unfollowing that person. Removing temptations from my life that would have any type of stronghold back to the New Age. So I know Stephen Bancars talks a lot about like removing occult objects and things from your home. I think that's super important, but I also think it's important that you're doing that with your mind because a big part of the New Age is the way in which you even think about things and everything becomes transformed. So you have to renew your mind. And so you have to be watching what you're feeding in. If you don't know how to feed your mind the spiritual food, the Bible yet, at least get rid of the toxic stuff that really can hinder your walk with Christ.
Amen. And it is, as you know, Tracy, it's amazing how spiritual life is where, you know, just like you said, quoted the Corinthians, bad company corrupts good morals, that it's amazing how someone can appear religious, or like it says that Satan disguised himself as an angel of light and his followers disguise themselves as righteous men. Where I've had people come up to me, like this one lady a couple of years ago, she came up to me and she goes, oh, Pastor Craig, you're so amazing. And she grabbed my hand. And she just grabbed my hand. And all of a sudden, this like lustful thought went in my head. I'm like, what is wrong with me? And it was just so weird. And so I was thinking, oh, no, something must be wrong with me. How did I all of a sudden just get this weird thought as soon as you touch my hand? And then all of a sudden, it's really neat how God, if you just trust the Lord, like said, for wisdom, then all of a sudden this police officer at our church said, oh, my goodness, stay away from that girl. She's a home wrecker. She's had like domestic violence where she's gone in and tried to seduce men. So she had probably a spirit of lust, but it was just so weird. So what I'm trying to say is that spirit, so that New Age spirit, if you're thinking, but they're disguising themselves as Christian New Age, you can pick that up without even meaning to. You could just, and that's where you have to be sensitive of yourself. Something like with the weed thing, something just isn't right here, you know, and that's the key too, is to really, like you said, ask for wisdom, but also check that, why don't I have peace here? If this is so right, why do I have anxiety? And you know that, right? You've had anxiety. That's a good indication that something's wrong, right? Yeah. I mean, it's not just, chemical. Anxiety can be a good thing to say, not right, not right, right? Because perfect peace have those whose hearts or minds are stayed on thee. That's the key. If you're with the Lord, then you should have peace. And if you have fear, like you said, it's because somehow you've gotten off from the Lord or there's something's not right. And so that's the key, is just, really, I don't want to go energy, right? But you know, we really do have to sense the spirit of someone.
Yeah,
we're
told to test the spirits. Yeah. And nobody explained to me, you know, what these things meant, right? Like I would hear about them, but I'm like, what does this mean? Right. There was really nothing out there to minister to that new ex-New Ager. Yeah. And that's why I put the podcast out, because I'm like, someone's got to be talking and ministering to the new ones coming out.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so you, and who would you recommend, like Doreen Virtue, Steve Mancars, anyone else you'd recommend?
Yeah, Steve. So when first out of my walk, I found Stephen Bancars and his reasons for Jesus, and he has a Patreon. I'm not like an affiliate for him or anything. Yeah. I just think he's awesome. Right? Like, I think he's awesome. he sent me his book. I read his book. Just absolutely incredible. And I actually, so I don't want to go too much longer, but when I first came out of the New Age, I'll never forget, someone told me that I had a spirit of paranoia, because I was like, why do I still have anxiety? If, you know, God can heal everything, I still have anxiety. And I had someone tell me, you have a spirit of paranoia. And I was like, God, do I really? And I was praying, and I'm like, please just show me a mentor. Like, I cried out to the Lord. I'm like, I need someone. And he gave me a dream about Stephen Bancars, and I never even knew who he was, found him. And I sent him a message. I'm like, you're probably going to think I'm crazy, but I had a dream, and the Lord told me I can trust you. He just ministered to me. He started talking to me, telling me about his book when it came out, and he sent it to me, and I read it, and I just thought it was amazing. So equipping ourselves with people that can be trusted, like discerning and testing their spirit, asking God, is this person of you, right? Testing the spirits. Doreen Virtue, she's amazing. Melissa Doherty. Yeah. Doherty. She's pretty cool. Her paintings are awesome. Mm-hmm. I would say those are my top three mentors. Yep.
And then your podcast. So can you tell people, like, how do they find that, or how do they find Faith to Freedom? And also, do you have a website, or what can they do to maybe have you as like a life coach with that, with the entrepreneurial and stuff?
Yeah, you could just go to tracywren.com. It's just TracyWren. And then my podcast is on iTunes, Spotify, iHeartRadio, pretty much anywhere you can listen to a podcast, that's where you'll find Faith to Freedom.
Perfect. And we'll have that in the description below, so everyone go check that out. And we've been so blessed to have you, and we know you have a family and you need to feed them, but thank you so much for joining us.
Can we ask, could you close in prayer for us? Would you do that?
Of course.
Pray for those who may be out there who've been kind of where you were, and just kind of pray for them. God would show them the way.
Yeah.
Oh, Father, thank you so much for this beautiful opportunity with Pastor Craig and Mariah. Lord, I just thank you that you have brought them in my life, in my path. As you know, I was praying and seeking for other mentors to learn more about you, Lord. And so I just ask that you bless their ministry, and you lift them up, and you surround them with the people that they need to continue working towards the kingdom and bringing other people closer to you, Lord. I pray that you bless Pastor Craig and his ministry, and you just fill his church with the people that are hungry for your word, Lord, that they find them, that they find the channel, and that you just work through the hearts of the young ex-New Agers, all of the ex-New Agers coming out of this movement of deception, Lord, that you guide them to a mentor that they can trust, and that you help them to be able to understand the truth and the word, and you help them to surround themselves and have fellowship and really plant themselves inside of a church and have that support and community to help them grow and learn more about you, Lord. I pray that everyone who is listening to this right now, that you just bless them and that you heal them in your mighty name, Jesus. I pray that you watch over them and their families, that you guard and protect their minds, and that you help them to understand that they can come to you and ask you for wisdom when they need it, when they are seeking and looking for answers and they don't know where to go and they're trying to direct their faith here, there. Lord, you show them that you are the only way, and that you are the Father of peace, the Prince of peace, and that you will give that to them, Lord. And please, I just pray for full-on faith for these people who have just any strongholds, Lord, still from the New Age, that they are just given the truth on how to break free from them, Lord. Help them to find deliverance and freedom. And we ask this in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Hey guys, thanks so much for joining us on Calvary Conversations. If you haven't already, please make sure to like, subscribe, and share this video. If you would like to listen to us wherever you get your podcasts, just type in Calvary Conversations. Also, if you want to check out our behind the scenes, you can follow us at Calvary Conversations on Instagram. Also, please make sure to check out our new merch, which is in the description below, and praying that you guys have a blessed week. Amen.